Okay, thank you, Adrian. And well, let me say first of all that I'm grateful to the organizers of this workshop, which, as we know, is part of the activities of the Business and Society Research Group at CRASH. Let me also add that I'm delighted to be back to CRASH, where I was a visiting fellow, well, reasonable time ago in 2004. Well, when the organizers of the conference asked me to say something which would fit the general topic of, well, basically relational approaches to the social economy, well, I found that they were asking me to perform a rather difficult task. As we all know, of course, the notion of social economy is not new, and we really run the risk, which is, I think, suggested by Matthias Klaes' title, of overworking the content of old bottles. Well, as we know, there were talks about the concept, if not about the term, of social economy already at the times of classical political economy, or maybe immediately after that. Even some of the most distinguished economists who actually brought about the marginalist revolution and its extensions eventually acknowledged some room for the concept of social economy. Let me just mention Léon Walras, but not only Léon Walras, also other people like Wicksell to a certain extent, and even Philip Henry Wicksteed, if we include in the notion of social economy also a treatment of behavior which is not necessarily self-interested. But this is not what I wanted to cover. Basically, what I want to cover is suggested by this list of topics. So I mean, let me go very briefly over this. I don't have many minutes to speak. Well, first of all, I think we must be aware that the roots of economic theory, whether neoclassical or of the classical type, are in the Enlightenment, broadly understood. I would then move on to a brief discussion of what we mean by an expansion of the Enlightenment project in order to cover the field of multiple reasons. This opens a discussion which, in principle at least, I would like to cover the role of connectivity in society and in the role of uncertainty in relation to that. It is here that I believe a possible route which may be of interest to us who are economists in this room, and perhaps to social scientists in general, is actually to approach Adam Smith's theory of moral sentiments, TMS, in an analytical mode. It seems to me, I'm increasingly persuaded, that the a core of Adam Smith's project is there rather than in The Wealth of Nations, and that a full analytical reworking of the TMS could provide very interesting foundations for a reworking of political economy as well. And that's almost an immediate consequence of that. I would have just a few words about a conception which is due to John Hicks when he argued that non-market organization must be a standard of reference when we want to understand market economies, a striking and I think enlightening remark. And I would eventually end with a few remarks for what concerns both applications and implications. Why? Can we reasonably argue that understanding the scope and status of of economic theory as it is today, as it is conceived, not only by mainstream people, actually, so I take here a very large representation of the state of economic theory, including both marginalist type, neoclassical type, and also classically based types of approach. Of course, as we know, a basic feature of the project of the Enlightenment is the idea that trade and division of labor are systematically associated with the improvement of society. Of course, it has been possible on the basis of that general framework then to develop economic thinking along two principal routes. This is actually rather well-known stuff, but I will just cover it very quickly. Of course, one of the principal routes is the exchange route, rooted in the idea that an economy of markets is associated with allocated properties, making it in some meaningful sense better than alternative arrangements. The second line of development, which is more focused on production, has actually its main core of attention in the analysis of division of labor, and in the general idea that mutual fitting and global connectivity are fundamental instruments in order bring about progress in connectivity and more generally progress in society. Let me just remark Jürgen Habermas' statement in a lecture he gave in Frankfurt, and which was eventually published in the New German Critique, 1981, where he is emphasizing that the roots of the project of modernity is the idea that greater specialization in knowledge-seeking production, also in governance, breeds better understanding and, at the same time, moral improvement. This is his way, and I think we should bear this general idea in mind. So, to end this first part of the presentation, if we look at economic theory through the mirror of the Enlightenment, we must actually understand that this mirror tells us that traders and or producers need to be fully distinguished from one another in order to make better patterns of connectivity possible, be it through exchange or through division of labor, which brings us to the conclusion that conditions for improvement presuppose a very specific configuration of social networks. Now, let me move to the second part. Why do I think that multiple reasons are becoming increasingly central if we want, in a way, to move beyond the project of the Enlightenment, as Habermas described it, not so much in terms of adopting counter-Enlightenment approaches, which are actually just the opposite of what I would like, but in order, actually, to reach a more expansive notion of the Enlightenment project. Well, fortunately, we have certain contributions already available which may help us in this thinking. One is Vernon Smith. Actually, as you know, Vernon Smith, who got a Nobel Prize in economics for his work on experimental economics, rather recently published here with the press, with CUP, a book on rationality in economics, which deals a great deal with basically the Scottish Enlightenment and generally the Enlightenment project. And there he outlines an interesting distinction, I think, between two different modes of reasoning. One is what, of course, that's not entirely new. We may even read Friedrich von Hayek behind this, but still it's interesting coming from an experimental economist. He's distinguishing between the constructive approach and the adaptive approach to reasoning. So he's making the point that we are wrong to think about a single-minded conception of reasoning and rationality. Raymond Boudon, the French philosopher and sociologist, some years ago wrote a very nice book called Raison bonne raison, Reasons, Good Reasons, where taking what I would perhaps consider a rather Aristotelian point of view, emphasizes the multiplicity of paths along which rationality can express itself. More generally, the multiple reasons approach tends to suggest a specific view of human action which sees it as exploratory rather than decisive. And here I think that we should also bring Adam Smith into this picture. According to Smith, good reasons, in the sense of plausible arguments, work essentially in the same way as we formulate judgments in the social domain, more or less in the same domain as we think that other people's behavior is more or less acceptable. But this way of thinking, the emphasis on multiple reason and multiple reasoning is of course then closely associated with the idea that multiplicity of motivation may be central. There may be many good reasons for a certain course of action. There may be good reasons for a course of action A and equally good reasons for course of action B. In order to assess and to contrast and compare different good reasons, we must explicitly accept the general framework that plurality of motivation is central. It is here, at this this twist of my argument, that basically I think that connectivity enters the picture, and with connectivity, uncertainty. Well, let me go back for a second about the emphasis on multiplicity in rationality. Multiplicity in rationality basically suggests that we should carefully consider the idea that there may be shifting grounds for decision making, for rational decision making. This has, I think, an interesting implication for what concerns connectivity, one of the basic features, as we have seen, of the Enlightenment project in economics. Because if we take the idea of multiple rationality and of manifold bonne raison seriously, we must accept that connectivity across human beings, both individuals and or social groups, may be guided by manifold motivations, by multiple reasons. Therefore, we must accept that it is generally thoroughly inappropriate both to generate connections from a fixed choice rule and also trying to understand connections as if they were emerging from a fixed choice rule. Let me recollect a view of the philosopher Patrick Soupis, who actually describes connectivity as a three-term relation involving one, the agent who proposes a connection, two, the agent who accepts the connection, and three, the relevant context. Context is central for this argument, because actually context makes clear that it is through it that we can actually trigger a certain mix of motives rather than another. Of course, uncertainty is precisely a field in which the multiplicity of reasonings of reasoning is central. And it is from this point of view that we must fully acknowledge that, in general, both connectivity emerges within a domain of uncertainty, and secondly, that situated reasoning, which is behind connectivity, may actually be understood as situated reasoning within a domain of uncertainty. Indeed, I would suggest, but I won't have much time to cover this point, which is actually a point I've covered in my forthcoming book that Adrian was referring to. I think we may suggest that the more we approach conditions of fundamental uncertainty or true uncertainty, uncertainty in terms of such that we don't know probability distributions, but we don't even know the space of events. Well, in this case, the more we want situated reasoning and connective, the more we face conditions of fundamental uncertainty, the more we come to realize that situated reasoning and connectivity required two conditions. Condition one, that agents should be skilled enough to assess their context in an appropriate way, but at the same time free enough to explore a full domain of possible connections. It is here that I believe Adam Smith's TMS comes to our help. In my view, Smith's TMS is probably the most comprehensive and sophisticated outline of a theory of social habits, institutions, and choices available today, but a theory in which connections are moved to center stage. What I think I would like to emphasize today about this whole issue of why Smith's TMS is so central for a theory of social connectivity and ultimately for a theory of the social economy is that the analytical structure of Smith's TMS leaves the notion of relevant social units as an open issue. In a way, the TMS looks at the social universe as a set of units brought about within social interaction, by means of social interaction, but the identity of such units is actually left open. Sum up in terms of my argument in terms of the TMS and of its possible use. If we take a TMS analytical framework, we might end up with a situation in which economic and social theory is no longer dependent on a preliminary choice of the relevant units of analysis. Please note how this differs from standard representation, philosophical representation of the project of the Enlightenment and of the project of modernity as described by Habermas. Secondly, the interaction domain of individuals or groups is to a certain extent determined at the same time as the problem to be addressed. So there are different domains of interaction depending on problems. We might even say, on top of that, that there could be different relevant units of analysis depending on context to be addressed. So not necessarily the individual, not necessarily the overall comprehensive groups, but all sorts of intermediate social forms. Finally, context, and this is very much in the spirit of TMS, is normally associated with a highly specific combinations of motives, and in the paper which supports my presentation I give a few instances taken from the TMS, where Smith explicitly acknowledges how a shift in context may induce a radical change in the way in which connections are activated, and in the way in which a certain code of behavior, a certain behavior, is considered to be acceptable or not. Now, One implication of this reconstruction of the TMS that I've been trying to outline is that through TMS, Smith calls attention to the complex motivational structure of human beings. He also calls attention upon the context dependence of the specific weights that individuals attach to different motives. So that a specific mix of weights may be appropriate in a certain context and completely inappropriate in a different context. An important implication of this is what I would call the endogenous determination of similarity structures in society. Namely, patterns of connectivity are not given for all. Patterns of connectivity are ultimately dependent on what kind of good reasons we have in specific context in order to activate certain patterns in lieu of others. A general lesson to be drawn is that general rules are not always adequate. It seems to me that precisely for this reason, we may understand actually the grounds behind John Hicks's remark, which I am referring to in the title of the slide. This is essentially because the social approval of motives is subject to two distinct sets of conditions: the context and the balancing of reasons relevant to that context. The notion of balancing of reasons is really central because it is this balancing of reasons which determines to what extent any given motive should be pursued when other values are taken into account. Generally speaking, therefore, any particular set of connections is best understood by taking a partially external standpoint. This is, I think, a central methodological remark, which I would take from Smith, I would take from the TMS, but I would also take as a bridge to John Hicks's remark, which you find here quoted in full, according to which it is helpful to use non-market organization as a standard of reference by which the market has to be judged. This is taken from his theory of economic history. Now, this is the general set of remarks, of course of a very preliminary kind, that I wanted to propose to you this morning. Now, let me go very briefly through applications and implications. Well, most important implications, in my view, are the following. Namely, economic interdependence always develops within a complex field of interaction and certainly cannot be understood if we adopt a too simple-minded reduction of complexity. Here, I put in brackets pure exchange or pure production models. I think that from the point of view of the general framework that I've been outlining, both fundamental research programs connected with the Enlightenment heritage of economic theory are ultimately constrained within, highly abstract, if you want, because reduction of complexity is often conducted to extreme, but at the same time such that while sometimes enlightening interesting problems and perspectives, they ultimately tend actually to end up with a too narrow-minded view of human connectivity. This is just a kind of very general remark. I think we would all need to think a bit more about this shortcoming, if it is a shortcoming. Second application, that has to do with it is just an example, in the field of credit arrangements and also in the field of productive coordination. It seems to me that both fields are such can as to provide instances in which multiple reasons may give rise to manifold patterns of connectivity. Take credit markets. Credit markets, as we know, presuppose a certain degree of trustworthiness, but are generally unable to function as enabling institutions for trustworthiness. In this connection, relational credit, and we are going to listen a bit, to hear a bit more about this today, with its emphasis on the trust-building features of embeddedness, of social embeddedness, may provide market relationship with the degree of redundancy. And redundancy here is a key concept that is required for transactions to take place smoothly under fundamental uncertainty. And the same view of redundancy appears as central when we move on to the consideration of productive networks. Productive networks, as we know, reflect the configuration of connections along the different dimensions of the production process, be it among tasks, capabilities, fabrication stages. They also reflect the hierarchy among those dimensions. And what is interesting is that both credit networks and productive networks, there's a huge work about this already available, are remarkable instances of imperfect coordination which might nonetheless be resilient. So, to end on this, in the case of credit networks, positive trust responsiveness may take precedence over individual deliberate objectives, and it may even open the way to the introduction of innovative instruments of credit policy aiming at reduction of overall uncertainty. In the case of productive networks, we are increasingly discovering that the inertia of seemingly inefficient technical and organizational practices may be actually associated with greater resilience of the overall system and greater adaptability of that system to shocks. Let me end my talk now with some emphasis on its implications. So, now I'm becoming rather synthetic in the statements. What this set of remarks entails is that, first, connectivity should be understood as the most distinctive feature of economic life. Two, plurality in motivation is central to connectivity. Three, there is a fundamental need to move across different dimensions of interdependence depending on context if we want to understand social connectivity adequately, if not in full. So, pluralism in connectivity, pluralism in causality, which is, by the way, nowadays a widely accepted philosophical position, and pluralism in theory. But of course, pluralism in theory brings us to a central question for us, specifically to the economists in this room. Which conceptual framework, then? Because we do need conceptual framework, maybe not only one, since we accept pluralism in theory, but how do we select which conceptual framework may be more relevant depending on context? Well, it seems to me that here we are facing a basic alternative. I don't claim this to be a general statement. It is simply an alternative on the basis of, I would say, some feeling I could detect in existing literature. One alternative suggests that situations themselves can be triggers of theory. And this is, in a way, quite consistent with John Hicks's view of conceptual frameworks as blinkers or means to concentrate attention on a certain set of issues, leaving other issues in darkness. But it seems to me there is a second alternative. The second alternative is suggested by recent work by Luigi Pasinetti, actually. I have in mind his book 2007, published again here by the press, called Keynes and the Cambridge Keynesians, a Revolution in Economics to be Accomplished. In book three, it's called book three, it's actually part three of that volume, Pasinetti develops a line of argument he's been pushing over the last few years, and that's the notion of separation theorems. The idea is that we must be able actually to discriminate between different conceptual frameworks in such a way as to identify which framework may be more useful in order to identify, to assess relatively permanent or fundamental relationships from frameworks which might be useful in order to understand more context-dependent relationships. In a way, alternative one puts it's rather agnostic, I would say, in terms of which theory we should choose, because the context, the situation, will be trigger of theory. Alternative two actually is much dependent on some idea of how we need to structure our domain of investigation from a hierarchical point of view. So, generally speaking, and here I am really, I think I'm getting short of time, and I'm really reaching the end of my presentation. Well, basically, I would like to call your attention to the fact that what I've been discussing, both in terms of analytical principles and also in terms of applications and implications, is something which perhaps from a philosophical point of view requires a conceptual shift, a mental shift, requires us to rethink the project of modernity which Habermas was describing. In a way, it seems to me that an open-minded approach to social and economic connectivity suggests a certain roots for the construction of a new theory of the social economy, which I see as closely associated with the intellectual project of a civil enlightenment, which is, as I take it, an expansion of the Enlightenment project as described by Jürgen Habermas. It is therefore an expansion of the project of modernity as described by him, but it is also a way to develop certain strands of thinking, which in my view were certainly present in the original Enlightenment project itself, and even if they were to a certain extent put aside in subsequent developments. So, to end up, this project of civil enlightenment in connection also with economic analysis would have three main features. It seems to me that its conceptual foundation will be to fully accept plurality in motivation and plurality in connectivity, which of course brings out the notion of a plural delineation of identity. Second, the analytical strategy. The analytical strategy would primarily be associated with our ability to decompose problem spaces and to make appropriate use of separation theorems, even in a much wider way than in the first proposal of this by Pasinetti. And third, the policy approach. We are going perhaps to discuss this issue more thoroughly today. It seems to me that this overall framework suggests an approach to policy emphasizing the need of identify degrees of freedom induced by plurality of motives and connections, degrees of freedom which obviously would also be degrees of freedom for what concerns policy action. Thank you so much. That's the end of my talk. Yeah, thanks.